إن الحمد لله
نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره
ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد إن خير الحديث كتاب الله خير الهدي هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم شر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أما بعد يقول الله عز وجل إنه من يشرك بالله فقد حرم الله عليه الجنة وأهله النار الله سبحانه وتعالى said whoever associates partner with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala whoever commits shirk with Allah عز وجل Allah makes the paradise of Jannah haram for them that means the person cannot enter the paradise another ayat Allah says something else Allah says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَنْ يُشْرِكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ دُونَ مَا ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ Allah doesn't forgive if somebody associates partner with him. And he may choose to forgive anything else. He subhanahu wa ta'ala also said, يَغْفِرُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيُعَذِّبُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ I may choose to forgive or I may choose to punish. So therefore, the main point of the discussion here is the gravity of the sin of committing shirk with Allah Azza wa Jalla. To bring a partner close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is said so simply, but the impact, the implication, the ramification of that is very serious. So today's discussion is not about shirk of salah or fasting or zakah or hijab or riba. Today is the most fundamental, most fatal, detrimental thing, which is for any Muslim, any person per se, in their life, what things they need to watch out for, which is committing shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah doesn't forgive shirk because this is a major matter. The Muslims today to understand that how can I be safe from it? Many of us may choose to say that we are safe from it, but perhaps we are not. I am going to point out some of the issues which is relevant to the culture, so perhaps we can fix our mistakes in the Azzawajal. But why shirk is so fatal, so important, so detrimental to us? Why is that? Why not something else? Nothing comes close to shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because putting somebody similar to Allah in any form or any fashion is not accepted by Allah. This goes against the very fundamental, very core of the creation of Allah azza wa jalla. It is not at the core of this religion. It is at the core of the very purpose of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah said in Surah Zariyat, Surah number 51, verse 56, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنِّ وَالْإِنْسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ I did not create the mankind and the jinn, per se the creation, except they obey me, be obedient to me, make ibadah to me and me only. Therefore, when anybody else comes close to Allah in any form of fashion, in a mind of a person or by an action of a person, you're putting a rival, a partner, an associate with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah doesn't accept that. He's the last one to be accepting this. So this goes against the very fundamental of the creation, very core of the creation of Allah Azza wa Jalla. And to make this point clear, Allah says, وَلَكَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةِ رَسُولَ أُمَّةِ الرَّسُولَ أَنْ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَاشْتَرِبُ التَّابُونَ Allah sent messengers throughout the ages, from day one till the last messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, only the common objective is that you do not associate, partner with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَاشْتَرِبُ التَّابُونَ Taghut is committing shirk and anything associated with that. And in opposition of shirk is the message of Tawheed. Allah sent the message of Tawheed to every nation. بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةِ رَسُولًا
I have raised messengers for every nation. Why? أَنْ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهِ To make ibadah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is that all? No. You can't make ibadah to Allah and somebody else along with it. So he said, أَنْ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهِ Obedience to Allah, ibadah to Allah, and also disassociation from shirk. So Allah, Allah and Barah, similar concept. So to understand, it is extremely important that every Muslim to make sure that we don't fall within this category of people who commit shirk with Allah Azza wa Jalla. Why the shirk is so important? Not important in a good sense, in a negative sense, to be cautious about that. Because this goes again against the core of the religion. And Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam himself did dua to Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Whom? Sahabas. Anytime you discuss our story, it is extremely important to understand the context of the story. If anybody look at the constitution of this country, per se, today you look a lot of things, doesn't even make any sense. Why they talk about union? Why are you talking about federation? I mean, it is already, because that day when they wrote the constitution, the country was not whole piece together. There's many division of factions there. So they have to write something which unites the nation, make a union. So today, looking at the constitution to you, it doesn't make much sense. You look at the amendments, it doesn't make sense to you. But it has implications that day when they wrote it. Surely people benefit from it now. Likewise, when I look at a statement from the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, I need to see what is this context. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam telling the companions who are the best of the people, telling them that be careful about shirk. Them, the companions, including Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, them. So them, the best of the people, upon them Allah is pleased. Allah is pleased with them. Radiallahu anhum. Allah is pleased with them. Now you and me, we're not sure. Most likely not Allah is the best. We should be even more careful about shirk. If the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught the Sahaba radiallahu anhum a dua. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika an ushriku bi shay'in a'lamuhu wa astaghfiruka mimma la ya'lam. There are many hadiths in this tone with various kind of matan, various kind of texts, and various type of asna, various type of salam. So the common message of this hadith is, with various kind of wording, it says, Allah, I secure protection from committing shirk with you. Who taught to whom? Messenger of Allah from teaching whom? The Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Look at this. Now you and I should be over-focused now. Now he also said, I ask Allah's forgiveness for the shirk about which I do not know, in case I commit them. So Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam telling these people, this is the best of the generation. قَالُوا قُرُنِي قِرْنِي ثُمَّ الَّذِينِ يَلُونَهُمْ ثُمَّ الَّذِينِ يَلُونَهُمْ كَمَا قَالَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ This is the best of the generation. Now you and I is far, far away from it, and really we care for it. So it is important to understand. Everything is important. Salah is important, zakah is important, not backbiting, not cheating, loving the dunya. These are problematic issues, yes? Making salah, putting hijab, not lying. These are important elements to be focused. But nothing comes close when it comes to committing shirk with Allah. Because, إِنَّهُ مَا يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةِ Whoever commits shirk with Allah, Allah makes the Jannah haram for them. You lost your business. Over. Everything done with. So that should draw our attention. However, a point to be known for, just to don't give a blank check. Anybody ask Allah's forgiveness, Allah forgives. Inni laghafar liman tab. I am the forgiving one who asks for forgiveness. So, saying that anybody come to Islam, the prior shirk is forgiven. Anybody does make mistake without knowing it, the door of tawbah is always open. But fact remains that the importance, the gravity of the sin by no means could be minimized or looked down upon. So having said this, now how does it apply to me? I'm a Muslim, I pray five times a day, I do Hajj. Allah Azza wa Jalla said that for the people, many people among the Muslims, وَمَا يُؤْمِنْ أَكْثَرُهُمْ بِاللَّهِ إِلَّا وَهُمْ مُشْرِكُونَ Most of the people and the believers, they believe upon Allah, however, they commit some shirk along with it. So, Allah talking about people who believe like us. So, this ayah is general, it applies to us. Now, let me point out again. This ayah, the primary audience of the Quran is the people in Arabian Peninsula. To be more specific, people of the Quraysh for about first 13 years, the people of the Quraysh. That's why one dialect of the Quran which we read is the Quraysh dialect, Quraysh dialect. So there is the final form of the preservation of the Quran in their dialect, out of the seven different dialects. Right? The Quraysh was the primary audience of the Quran. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the Quran in their language. فَإِنَّ أَنْزَلْنَاهُ قُرْآنٌ عَرَبِيًّا لَعَلَّكُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ. Quran is revealed in Arabic, the people in the Arabian peninsula can understand, not somebody in Germany. So therefore we understand primary audience is the people of Mecca for now. And they are told this. And Sahaba along with sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if this statement is applicable to them, can you imagine how much it applies to us? I keep insisting this point to bring the consciousness up to the level that I understand this belongs to me. This ayah pointing to me, not to somebody else. Anytime we read an ayah, we memorize it to point to somebody else. You say, brother Allah says this, like I'm a lecturer. I want to point somebody to else. You know, brother Allah said this, that is applied to you, not to me. This kind of attitude we have. May Allah protect us and forgive us. Especially people speaking from a mimbar, may Allah forgive us first. Because a lot of kalam, but no action, is detrimental to the person who speaks. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who listen to a lecture and benefit from it. And I'm the first one who should be benefiting from it. That's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَيَجَلَنَا مِنَ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَمِعُونَ الْقَوْلِ فَاتَّبِعُوا أَحْسَنَهُ. Now, having said this, the shirk applies to us. Now, you may say that, brother, you mean to tell me I commit shirk? You as a person, I do not know. But as a whole, as a community, yes, we do. I'm going to point out something. The most evident and obvious type of shirk, which is, for example, worshiping an idol. These are obvious types. So these are the kabar, these are the major shirk, major sin. A smaller type of shirk, these are the one fatal for us today. So let's go to the major shirk for sake of discussion, academic discussion. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, الَّذِي جَعَلَ لَكُمُ الْأَرْضَ فِرَاشًا وَالسَّمَاءَ بِنَاءً وَأَنْزَلَ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً فَأَخْرَجَ بِهِ مِنَ الثَّمَرَةِ رِزْقًا لَكُمْ فَلَا تَجْعَلُوا بِاللَّهِ أَنْدَادًا. Allah said, Allah spread the earth for you and raised the heaven up for you. From the heaven Allah gives water. So from the earth the vegetation grow. Why? So you can sustain yourself. Inna Allah huwa razzaqul dhul quwwati al-matin. Allah give rizq. Allah said, I want to give rizq. So فَلَا تَجْعَلُوا لِلَّهِ أَنْدَادًا. I created the earth and spread it. I created the heaven and elevated them. I bring the rain and bring the food for you. So please, knowing that, I'm the one who's doing everything. So do not associate partner with me. فَلَا تَجْعَلُوا لِلَّهِ أَنْدَادًا أَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. Knowing you do not put rivals, do not associate partner with Allah Azza wa Jalla. The partnership could be in many form and fashion, right? For example, people worship idols, saying that time of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, you know, and people before the time of Noah, and many of the Lat and Uzza and all this, right? Idols. You create a form, right? You create a wooden idol, a rock, or something, and you start worshipping. You create it, and you worship. Allah Musta'an. At the least, the one you create, they should worship you because you created that. You create a wooden idol, the idol should worship you because you are the creator. Reversing the process, you are done worshipping them. Allah Musta'an. This is ajeeb. No sense in people's mind. And you tell them that, they say you don't understand idol worship. There's the philosophy behind it. There is one, by the way. But beside the point. But then when the Meccan and other mushrikeen was asked, pointed this out to them, they said, مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا يُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ ذُلْفًا. Really, we don't worship them, by the way, for the information. We just use them as an intermediate point, an access point to go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a router, an internet. This is a router. Access point to go to service provider, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Allah said you don't need a service access point. Allah said, فُدُعُونِ فَقَدْ. That means finishes there. Ask me as a direct statement. Nothing indirect. Though there is some other ayat people take out of context, I'm going to talk about this later. But the point is this type of shirk, which is physically associating partner with Allah, you obviously know it's haram, and we're not going to do it as Muslims. We know that. And there's other ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, مِنَ النَّاسِ مَا يَتَّخِذُ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ أَنْدَادًا يَحِبُّونَهُ كَحُبِّ اللَّهِ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ. This ayah has two parts. First part is one thing, second part is another thing. First part I'm going to talk about now, second part towards the end. First part Allah said, from the people, from the مِنَ النَّاسِ مَا يَتَّخِذُ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ أَنْدَادًا. They take somebody beside Allah as somebody to worship, to call upon, to seek refuge, and do many other things. Isti'aza, isti'ana, so on and so forth. So, this element, putting somebody close to Allah in different levels, is not acceptable. Now you may say, brother, I don't call anybody else. I don't go to some idol and ask for it. I don't. So it doesn't apply to me. Alhamdulillah. But lacking something else applied to you, which Rasulullah said, he wars, he fears the most for this ummah, is al-shirk al-asghar. Sahaba asked, radiallahu anhu, وَمَنْ يَا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ سَلَّمَ Who is this shirk al-asghar? قَالَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ سَلَّمَ الرِّيَا كَمَا قَالَ That Rasulullah sallam, that it is the riya, showing off. This is one form of smaller shirk. Doing anything else, doing any act of worship, ibadah, to please somebody else, beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let me repeat this. As simple as that. And he sallallahu said, this kind of shirk called asghar al-riya can creep into a person without any notification to the person. Person cannot see it. It is so hidden. It's like a black ant in a moonless night, in a night, a black ant crawling over a black rock. You can't see it. It's camouflage. So therefore, us, we are getting into the shirk in and out without knowing the detailed specs of it. But today, inshallah, we need to focus on it. A simple example. You come to the masjid, leading the salah, right, for example. And you see a lot of people came in, and some big shot people came in, so you recite the Quran in a melodious way, right? Normally, you don't do that. So your impression is that I want to just, you know, get my audience to know that I'm here. I'm in town. People got to know it. And next time I pass by, people say, brother, can you come in 5 minutes and recite the little Quran? If that's no objective, you already committed shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a certain level. Certain level. Ramadan, you need to give iftar. You give iftar, everything was done. And you gave all this like $2,000 iftar and nobody said your name in the microphone. So you feel like, you know, all this money went down the drain, no recognition. So somebody passing by the door, someone said, how is the food? You good? Brother, I just want to make sure you guys are happy because, you know, I put a lot of effort behind you. Oh, you want to get iftar? Yes, mashallah, brother, you're so kind, mashallah, you know. Now you already messed up the whole thing. Just this little mashallah from a person who will forget tomorrow morning. You lost your ajr. You want to show some people, but you should be showing the Lord of the people. That is the objective of ibadah. And Allah created you. Allah created the heaven and the earth, bring the food for you, give you the life and death, and He is the one that everything, and you want somebody else recognition. And they forget tomorrow. But Allah doesn't forget. Allah said, وَمَا كَانَ رَبُّكَ نَسِيَا Allah doesn't forget. So if you do some good, Allah knows. وَمَا تُنْفِقُ مِنْ شَيْءٍ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ بِعَلِيمٍ Whatever good you spend for Allah, Allah knows that. It is enough that He knows. Why somebody else has to recognize you? The problem is, this is a certain form of shirk. So we all fall into this group in different levels. Different levels. So may Allah forgive us. We are human. And we are created weak, so it is obvious weakness creeps into the person. But we have to be meticulous and cautious. See where this thing is coming inside me. Which direction? So I got to be cautious and block it. Ask Allah's protection. And the dua, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika an ushrik bika shay'an a'lam. Allah, this hadith came in Imam Ahmed, by the way. So we need to say that Allah, I seek your protection, seek refuge in you from committing shirk with you. Allah asking your protection and asking your forgiveness because some of the shirk I do, I don't even know that. So I can't seek your protection from which I don't know. So what I do without knowing, ask your forgiveness. So you cover all grounds. So we have to constantly do this. Having said this, we have to understand the other part of the shirk, which is the most dangerous part. Other part of shirk are minor shirk. They are various types. For example, if you love somebody so much, like close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that may lead to shirk. You fear something more than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in certain way, it may lead to shirk. You depend on something in such a level which that dependence only belongs to Allah, that could lead to shirk. Can you imagine that? That we fall into these groups. I'm going to give some examples. Allah says, وَمَا يَتَّكِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا If you depend on Allah, Allah will always open a way for you. No matter what kind of jam you're in, Allah will figure something out. He does all the time. Allah is the one. Now dependence on Allah is important. Dependence on somebody else is not important. But in human interaction, you depend on somebody. Brother, mic is not working. Can you fix it for me? Then yes, you're depending on somebody. This dependence is allowed. Why is it allowed? Because you depend on somebody and he can deliver. A sheikh can deliver what you're depending upon. on this person. Can I get a ride to home? You have a car, you can drive, so please take me. That dependence is allowed because the person is given the capacity by Allah to execute that level of service for you, to provide you that service. The person has the capacity to do it. That dependence is okay. But depend, can you extend my life? Allah gives and takes from it. In essence, Allah also gives risk, yes. But Allah gives sabab behind the risk. For example, Allah is a Razzaq, so why should I go to work and depend on my job? You do not depend on your job. It depends on Allah. وَفِي السَّمَاءِ رِزْقُكُمْ وَمَا تُعَدُونَ. Risk is fixed. It is, you're not depending on the money coming from the dunya. ولكن there is sabab, sunan of Allah Azza wa Jal, cause and effect. Allah put into the system. That's all He wants you to go along with the system with these certain limitations so you don't cross the boundary and depending on something else. If you believe, my medicine gives me cure. Allah gives the cure, but Allah said you take the medicine as a sabab, as a cause. That's why Allah said, once you finish Salatul Jum'ah, فَإِذَا قُضِيَتِ الصَّلَاةِ فَانْتَشِرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَابْتَغُوا مِنْ فَضْلِ اللَّهِ. Finish Salatul Jum'ah, go to the earth, go to your job. Simple as that. So Allah said it's allowed to go, depend on the job, to give the effort, to get in return some risk. But risk must be allocated by Allah ahead of time, regardless. Otherwise, no matter how much effort you give, you're not going to get it. So you must know that part. But Allah said give effort. Well, I'm going to give effort. So you, there's a fine line between the two. You need to understand. Now, next point. Allah said, فَلَا تَخُوفُوهُمْ وَخُوفُونِي إِن كُنْتُمْ مُؤْمِنِينَ. Do not fear the shayateen. Do not fear them. Fear me if you're a believer. Now, as a Muslim, we may tend to believe or fear something, or a human, you fear something, right? You see a snake, you get scared. You see a lion, you get scared. This is normal human response to certain events. These are allowed because Allah put their weakness in the human system. That's okay. But you fear something else beyond that, which is not the qualification of that, the characteristics of the thing, then you can fear. For example, the lion is in England now, you're fearing the lion from here. And that's the problem with you. That's the problem. Now, what I'm going to now, when somebody is dead in a grave, you fear the person may do something to you. A dead person can't do anything. Neither fear cannot harm you, cannot benefit you. So you go to a dead person's grave, if I say something bad about this person in the grave, he may just come out and do something to me. This level of fear is haram. Because this fear belongs to Allah. The man or woman incapacitated doesn't have a capacity to do anything else from the grave. So now you fear the person beyond the capacity of the person, then you're fearing something which is not legitimate, which is not legal in Islam to do it. However, you fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whether you're in the moon, in the Mars, in England, Germany, New York, in Carolinas, wherever you are, you fear Allah because this dominion belongs to Allah. Even though He is above the seven heavens, الرحمن على الأرش استوى ولكن he said أسمع وأرى. I hear and I see. نحن أقرب إليه من حبل الوريد. I am closer to you than your jugular vein. That is close to you. Right? Even though He is above the heaven. Now you fear Him whether anybody sees or not, because He sees all the time. A dead person in the grave cannot see all the time. So fearing this person, illegal. Fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all the time, it is wajib on you. So fear two different times. One is allowed, one is not allowed. Now going back to dependence, this culture depends the most. Depending on something else besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For protection. Many people wear amulets, or tawis, right? There's three hadith I'm going to quote, one from Tirmidhi, one from Abu Dawud, another one I forgot. All of them are dedicated to the line. So, three hadith, one of them Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, sahabi. It's a long hadith, each of them I'm going to summarize. Ibn Mas'ud came to home and he found his wife radiallahu anha wearing something. So she said, what is this? She said, I have some problem with my eyes, some kind of feelings, some problems with my eyes. So I went to someone, a Jewish person, to get a spell or something to fix it. So it is good now. And Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu took it away from his wife and said that this doesn't belong in this house, because the Prophet ﷺ categorized this thing as a shirk, depending on something else, besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But there's a legal form of ruqyah, legal form of cure for diseases, yes. For example, Surah Al-Fatiha. Go to your doctor, doing a CAT scan and take some medication for it. Yes, doing a blood transfusion. Yes, this is okay. this is cause and effect. But this thing of issue of in the realm of spirit, like somebody blow on you and you become cured, this has to be a legal form of healing. For example, Surah Al-Fatiha, Mu'adhidain, Surah Falak and Nas, and this other stuff you are allowed to do from the Kitab Sunnah to do. There's some other dua for evil eyes, so on and so forth. So only those limited ones are allowed in this religion to do. Anything beyond that is not acceptable. So many Muslims, I see many Muslims have something on their neck, right? Amulet, taweez, right? Right? They have in their hands, some people, as they read. Like, and little kids, I read in a book, little kids from certain culture, the mother or father put some black dots on the head or something to be protected from something, evil eye. These are the things depending on something else beside Allah. So these are the things are shirk al-asghar, some form of smaller shirk. We've got to be careful about this. Some people believe in superstition, for example. Somebody told me, you scratch your hand, you get money. Somebody dropped the comb. I read about those things. They drop the comb, like, and believe that something will happen to you, or something like this. You're going somewhere, and you trip on your shoes or a cable, then or something, then you think something bad is going to happen. If something bad is going to happen, it's been written 50,000 years prior to the creation of the system. 50,000 years ago. So if it is there, you can change it. And if it's not there, you can make it. Period. So Allah said, وَمَا يَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ. Whoever depends on Allah, فَهُوَ حَسْبُ. He's enough of him. So depend on Allah, not get shifted by anything else. So another man came to Rasulullah. 10 people came to Rasulullah for giving ba'ah to allegiance to him. Out of that, Rasulullah took ba'ah from 9 people. One person he did not take. He said, Ya Rasulullah, you took ba'ah from 10 or 9 of them, not me. Why? You are holding an amulet. In his pocket, he has something, seashell or some kind of taweez, something he depends on. Superstition. He holds him on it. He said, that is shirk. Unless you get rid of that, you can come to tawheed. The man is to throw it out, then he took ba'ah to him. See, this is so simple. What's the big deal? This is the big deal. To whom? To the Creator. It's not a big deal to you? Too bad. You have to make it a big deal. Because the Lord doesn't accept that. And you get angry about it. You get angry about it, you need to fix it. Understood? The last one, Rasulullah went to Hunayn, right? On the way, there's a lot of new Muslims toward the end. A lot of new Muslims, and they're going some kind of battle or things like that. The Mushrikeen hang their swords on a tree, they're seeking barak or something like that. So, Sahaba said, Rasulullah, can you please make a tree like them so we can put our sword through and get some good feeling out of it? Rasulullah did not approve that. And as a matter of fact, he gave a lecture on this topic, told them that this kind of dependence on something else beside Allah is not accepted in this religion. So fearing something beside Allah in certain level is not acceptable. Depending on something else beside Allah in certain level is not acceptable. Right? And calling on something beside Allah is not acceptable also. And that is the most important part I'm going to cover now. I waited for most people coming. Many Muslims today, I saw my own eyes about 30 years ago. I was shocked, somebody prostrating a grave of so-called pious person. Who pious? I really don't know. Allah said, فَلَا تُزَكُّ أَنفُسَكُمْ هُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِمَنِ اتَّقَى. Do not say you pious, you know, self-piety, better than thou. Allah knows who is really pious. So therefore, pointing finger to yourself as pious is not acceptable. Having said that, somebody, wali of Allah, or this peer, and those kind of stuff, somebody died in a grave, you go ask this person, Shaykh, do that to me. Who are you asking, by the way? Good morning, who may I ask you? The person is dead. If you could hear, he should be outside listening to somebody else. Listen to the Quran, making wudu. He's dead. He's dead, that's why he had a janazah. He's dead, that's why he had a grave. He's dead, that's why his wealth of inheritance was distributed. So dead man can think. Even Rasulullah can hear. Because this characteristic is separated from death to the living. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears all the time. Asma wa ra. I hear all the time. وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ. If my servants ask about me, tell them I'm close. Allah said, أُدْعُونِي أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ. Ask me, I'll reply to your call. So Allah said, ask me, nobody else. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ عَنْ عِبَادَتِي سَيَدْخُلُونَ جَهَنَّمَ دَاخِرِينَ. So ibadah, dua as an ibadah, by extension of the ayah here. It's a proof. Dua is an ibadah. And in the hadith said, ad-du'a huwa al-ibadah, kama qala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Du'a in itself is an act of worship. Worship should be directed to Allah and Allah only, nobody else. So asking for somebody else, but asking a living person to give you $1, if the person can give, they will give. This is Allah. Asking a dead person is beyond the capacity of that person. So if you ask a dead person, you're giving divinity to the person. You're giving asma sifat, Allah's characteristics to a dead person. Inna Allah hayyun la yamut. Allah is ever living, never dies. You're making somewhere that this person is living also, he can hear you. So you're giving characteristics of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The asma al-husna of Allah azza wa jalla to a creation. That's a form of shirk, and it's a big one. There's no minor shirk. This is a big one. You're calling some dead person living. Allah is ever living, and nobody lives beyond that. So therefore, giving this kind of characteristics is shirk. So many Muslims go to grave, or go to a dead person, sit down and ask some dead person. How do you ask a dead person? Now, what if the person is living? The person lived in India. You sit down, you say, Shaykh, give me that. That's shirk, without a discussion. Because Allah to be asked, nobody else beside that. But if the person in front of you ask him, person there can hear it. And this person cannot deliver something which is beyond the control of the person. So I can ask somebody, so, you know, make my health better. The person himself is sick. Do you understand this? I mean, this is common sense logic. How can somebody do that? The Muslims are doing it. And Allah said they are doing it. Prophet ﷺ said they are doing it. We need to stop it, that's the point. Depending on Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only. Wa qawli hadha astaghfirullah wa li wa lakum. إن الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه. Two more points. I'll talk about وسيلة. Let us say it now because it's connected. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَابْتَغُوا إِلَيْهِ وَسِيلَةً. Look for an excuse to get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And people find excuse, their other people excuse, illegal, invalid excuse. مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا يُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفَى. We worship the idols only to get close to Allah. Idol is not the objective. So like the people, I go to the shaykh when the dead person, not to worship him really, I want to be connected through him. You don't need no connection. Allah is there. He can hear. Allah is direct. Uduni astajib lakum. Call upon me, I will respond to it. Allah hears. Before you think, he knows it already. So you don't have to go to anybody. It doesn't make sense. But what kind of wasila? Surah Al-Kahf, Surah number 10. Muslim should read in the Yawmul Jum'ah. Surah number 18, I'm sorry. Verse number 110. The last ayah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, قُلْ إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مِثْلُكُمْ, I mean human like you. قُلْ إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ. يُحَى إِلَيَّ أَنَّمَا إِلَهُكُمْ إِلَهُ وَاحِدٌ. فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ أَحَدًا. If you want to get close to Allah, if you want to get close to Allah, you don't need an intermediate person. But you do what? عَمَلًا عَمَلًا صَالِحًا. You do good deeds. This is the wasila. This is an excuse. You look for an excuse to do good deeds. To Allah. Allah did for you. I make worship for you only Allah. This is the wasila. And another thing, do not make shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are the two things Allah said. Good deed, don't make shirk. You get close to Allah. You don't need other wasila. No other excuse. And Luqman told his son, alayhi salatu salam, Ya bunayya la tushrik billah. Inna shirka la zulmun azim. Do not associate partner with Allah. This is the worst form of crime you can do. Zulm you can do. You got to be careful. So wasila is not that. Many people make up stories. We do not have time. There's books, Shaykh Albani has a book on this called Tawassul, about 250 pages on this topic of wasila only. You can read it if you want. Having said that, the last point, many people have extra love for Prophet ﷺ, which you should. And Nabi Allah bin Mu'minin min anfusihim. Prophet ﷺ is closer to you than your own soul. You should love him. It's part of Iman. But how to show the love, there is some limitations to it. You just can't show love anyway. You want. Love should be set up the way the person you love, he has to accept it. Like, if I have a diabetes, right? Problem with sugar. You love me, bring a lot of sweet. I can't eat it. So your manifestation of love is mistaken, by the way. You need to think it again and redo the process. I can't take it. So your love really means nothing to me at this point. Your emotion accepts it, but the action is not. So therefore, emotion in itself is not enough to manifest love. There is some methods for it. Many people believe Prophet ﷺ still can hear them. He do salat al-Nabi, he cannot ﷺ hear by himself. Some angel has to transmit intermediate person. Allah put an angel on a job for that purpose. He can hear, only Allah can hear, subhanAllah. He can deliver, Allah can deliver whatever you need. Because that is the reason Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam himself made dua, Ya Muqallib al-Qulub, for hidayah, for sabbat, for istiqama in deen, Rasulullah made dua, Ya Muqallib al-Qulub, sabbit qulubana ala deeni, sabbit qalbi ala deeni. Ya Allah, make my heart firm in the religion. He is Allah still making dua to somebody else. So why are you going to ask him? Go up to his Lord, and his Lord said, Udu'uni astajib lakum, call upon me. So many people go to Medina, go to the grave, you know, the grill around the grave, the protection, people hold on it, kiss on it. Why are you kissing a gold-plated medal? Just want to know it. Does it make any sense? What is the faculty? What is the intelligence of the people? Many people go to the Haram, to the Kaaba, and start wiping on the cloth. This cloth came from another country, some tailor people made it. It has no special quality on this. Allah Mustafa, please use some brain. And people touch the tiles on the floor. Tiles probably came from China. Allah ilaha illallah, what are you kissing the tile for? But one thing you can do Hajr Aswad. Ibn Umar or Umar, one of the two, radiallahu anhu, I forgot who said that. That innaka hajar, you are a stone. And you can't benefit me, neither you can harm me. Only I'm kissing you because I saw sallallahu alayhi wa sallam doing so. Act of ibadah by the obedience of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You can make your own ibadah. You can't make one. You only follow one which is already shown. So therefore, to be understood what to do and what not to do. This is important. So many people ask Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, let me give you two ayah from the Quran to conclude. Why I'm saying at the last, if the Prophet can do it, nobody else below him can do it. Is that clear? Allah told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لَيْسَ لَكَ أَمْرِ مِنَ اللَّهِ شَيْءٍ. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in my decision you have no share. Allah made the decision. He is the universe, His kingdom, and He is the king, and she has no partner with that. Allah said, قُلِ اللَّهُمَّ مَالِكَ الْمُلْكِ. To Allah belongs the kingdom and authority. So nothing has come close. Period. No discussion after that. He loved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he loved Ibrahim. Love is love, but it's not share of authority. Period. So you don't ask anybody but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you do such, you're committing shirk. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ اسْتَكْبِرُونَ عَنْ عِبَادَتِي سَيَدْخُلُونَ جَهَنَّمَ دَاخِلِ. If you ask somebody else beside Allah, committing shirk, they continue doing that, Allah may throw the person in the hellfire, regardless of their prayer, by the way. The Prophet ﷺ said, no authority with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لَيْسَ لَكَ أَمْرِ مِنَ اللَّهِ شَيْءٍ. To Allah, the ayah I said before, that is another ayah similar to it, that to Allah, you cannot associate authority with Him. The last ayah, the Prophet ﷺ said, quote, لَا أَمْلِكُ لِنَفْسِي نَفْعَ وَلَا ضَرَّ إِلَّا مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ. I do not have authority, no power to do good or bad to myself, except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said that in the Qur'an, not from the Sunan, from the Qur'an, that I do not have power to do anything on myself, neither good nor bad. وَلَوْ كُنْتُ أَعْلَمُ الْغَيْرِ لَأَكْثَرْتُ مِنَ الْخَيْرِ وَمَا مَسْتَمِيَ السُّوءِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that if I knew the unseen, who said that? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If I knew the unseen, the ghaib, I will do good for me and nothing bad will touch me. He said that sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I don't know. If the Prophet doesn't know, your wali and this, no way they know that. Period. And if the Prophet cannot deliver, doesn't have authority to do things, nobody else can do. But yes, the Prophet can ask Allah. His dua has special privilege. Yes. But he has to ask Allah, not to himself sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So here is the point. If the Prophet can give while he died, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and when he is living, if he asks something from the dunya, he can give if he has it. And unseen stuff, he has no control over it. He has to ask Allah. So you also have to ask Allah. He depends on Allah. You also depend on Allah. He fears Allah. You also have to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing else. As a Muslim, need to understand that in this life, every little thing we do, it counts. This may actually be something very serious. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us, to guide us to the right path and protect us from any shirk with Him. Any form of shirk. This is He doesn't forgive. Say, إِنَّهُ مَا يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةِ. Whoever commits shirk with Allah, Allah will forbid them from going to the Jannah forever. We need to be careful, inshaAllah. Allahumma اغْفِرْ لَنَا ذُنُوبَنَا إِسْرَافَنَا فِي أَمْرِنَا وَثَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَنَا وَانصُرْنَا عَلَى الْقَوْمِ الْكَافِرِينَ. اللَّهُمَّ أَسْنِ عَاقِبَتَنَا فِي الْأُمُورِ كُلِّهَا أَجِرْنَا مِنْ خِزْيِ الدُّنْيَا وَعَذَابِ الْآخِرَةِ. وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. رَحِمَكُمُ اللَّهُ.